So welcome to this course on analog MOS circuit design. And this particular course is an advanced course as compared to what you have studied in the last year, that is on electronic circuits. And in electronic circuits, we have basically discussed about the various types of analog circuits using the diodes and the bipolar junction transistors. So we did not mention any kind of MOS devices for the construction of those amplifiers in that particular course. However, this course on analog MOS circuit design deals with the design of several analog circuits with the help of the MOS devices. Now, this particular lecture being an introductory one, so let me just give you some basic introduction about the characteristics and the behavior of the MOS device. And hopefully you have got enough understanding about the device physics of MOS device in your course on basic electronics engineering, which is supposed to be offered in the first year, first semester. So these two courses are the prerequisite for this analog MOS circuit design. One is the basic electronics engineering, and the second one is electronic circuits or analog electronic circuits. Now to start with, let me just give you the notion of a capacitor. How can we build a capacitor? So with this understanding, let us go into the detail of this, the MOS devices. So as you know, for any capacitor, we require two conductive plates. So two conductive plates are there, and in between those two conductive plates, we should have some insulating device, insulator. So let me just consider, this is one conductive plate. So two conductive plate separated by some insulator. So this is the conductive plate one, and this is the second one, second conductive plate. And in between these two conductive plates, we do have one insulator. So let me just show you the insulator with a different color. So suppose this is the insulator in between these two conductive plates. And this gives you the notion of a capacitor. So this is an insulator. And these are the two conductive plates. Conductive plate. So let me call this is conductive plate one. And this one is a conductive plate two. Now, normally you know that this conductor, so conductive plate two. So normally we can use the metals as a conductive plate, but let us assume that this conductive plate one is being implemented by some polysilicon kind of thing, which is having a moderate amount of conductivity. And the second one, the second conductive plate is being implemented by some semiconductor. Say, let's consider p-type semiconductor. Because you know that these semiconductors, they are, as far as their conductivity is concerned, so they are in between the insulator and the conductor. So they'll be having a certain amount of conductivity. Okay? And suppose we apply a voltage between these two conductive plates. So we are taking the connection, wire connection. So let's apply some voltage between these two conductive plates. So these two plates are being separated by an insulator. And let's assume this is a p-type semiconductor, and let's this is p-type semiconductor. And let us apply some voltage between these two conductive plates. Some voltage, say let it be V1. Suppose V1 with the polarity as shown, this side positive, this side negative. Now, under this condition, as you know, you have two conductors, and in between them you have an insulator. So as soon as you apply this voltage over here, so charges, the positive and the negative charges, will be accumulated. So you have the positive charge over here, positive charge over here, and the negative charge over here. Because you know that this p-type semiconductor is having holes as a magnetic carrier, and they'll be having certain amount of electrons as a magnetic carrier. So obviously they'll be having a kind of some amount of electrons available in the p-type semiconductor as the magnetic carriers. So these positive and the negative charges, they will be accumulated over here like this. And you know the basic definition and the corresponding equation corresponding to the applied voltage and the capacitance. You know, this is the governing equation. Q is equal to C into V. That is the governing equation. So the charge accumulated over here is nothing but the C times V, where V is the applied voltage. So here you can write C times V1, where V1 is the applied voltage. So that is fine. And as long as this construction is fixed, I mean, the conductivity of these two plates are fixed, and as long as the type of the insulator is fixed, and the difference between these two, so let me consider that this is the difference. This is the thickness of the insulator. So let us consider this thickness to be, say, T. So as long as these constructions are fixed, so the capacitance of this particular structure will be fixed. Now, if you increase the value of V1 over here, if the amount of voltage, if this voltage is increased, then obviously you understand that being a fixed value of capacitor, the corresponding charges, these positive and negative charges, will be enhanced as governed by this particular equation. Q is equal to C times V. If C is constant, and if you increase V, the Q will also be increased. So you have more number of positive charge over this plate and more number of negative charge over this plate. Now, we are particularly interested in observing this particular distribution or the concentration of this negative charge. So as you increase V, as V is increased, or in this case, as V1 is increased, as V1 is increased, this implies the charge will also increase for a particular C. And that means the density of electrons in the p-type semiconductor, so the density of electrons, which implies density of electrons, will also increase. Instead of having a p-type semiconductor, if you have an n-type semiconductor, in that case you need to apply negative voltage over here, and in that case this plate will be having negative charge and this plate will be having positive charge, and we can write the density of holes will increase. We are particularly interested in observing the density of electrons in this particular conductive plate. So the density of electrons will also increase. That is the first observation, what you can make out of it here. And the second observation is that if we if we change the construction, and if we reduce the value of T, I mean the difference between these two conductive plates, then what happens from your basic understanding on device physics? If the difference between these two conductive plates are reduced, that means if the T is reduced, then these two plates will come close to each other, and as a matter of fact, the capacitance value will be more. Then for a fixed value of the voltage, the charge accumulation will be increased. So that is the second observation what we can make out of it. That means if T is reduced, I mean the difference between these two plates, this implies the C value will increase for a fixed V. So this one is for a fixed C. So this entire thing is for, so let me write over here. So this is for a fixed value of capacitance. And this is for a fixed value of voltage, fixed V1. There also, if C is increased for a fixed value of V, there also it implies the Q will also increase, and which implies the density of electrons. I should not write electrons, rather it should be like density of negative charge carriers, because I don't know whether these negative charge carriers are solely coming from the electrons or from the negative ions. Density of electrons, or you can also say like negative charge carriers. Gradually you understand what is the source of this particular negative charge carriers. So this will also increase. So this is the one observation what you can make out of this particular structure. But this will not help us in understanding the concept of MOS device. This basic analysis or this basic understanding is quite obvious to you. Now, once you have some amount of electrons over here, then what you can do is you can apply, instead of applying this voltage between these two plates, then what you can do is you can apply another voltage between these two ends of this particular conducting plate. What I mean to say is that now, since you have some electrons, so now what you can do is you can apply. So if you apply some voltage between these two ends of the conducting plate, suppose we are applying another voltage between these two plates. This side positive and this side negative. This is plus, this is minus. Let this voltage be V2. Now you have some amount of electrons, free electrons here. And if we apply some positive voltage over here, over this plate, then what happens? The electrons will be attracted and the electrons will flow in this particular direction. So the electrons will start flowing in this direction, from the left to the right for this particular structure. Or in other words, the conventional current will flow from this end to that end. That means from this, so let me mark. So let me consider this point to be say point A and this point to be say point B. So as soon as I apply a voltage V2 with a positive polarity over here and negative polarity over here, the electrons will be moving from the point B to the point A. And the conventional current, because you know that the current direction is just opposite of that flow of electron. So the conventional positive current will be flowing from point A to point B and back to this source end, like this. Moreover, if you can, for a fixed value of V2, so now you have two different voltages. You have one voltage V1 and you have another voltage V2. Now suppose V2 is fixed. V2 is fixed and you are increasing the value of V1. Now already you have seen that if V1 is increased, then for a fixed structure of this capacitor, the density of electrons, the density of mobile charge carriers over here will also increase. Now if the density of electrons over here increases for a p-type semiconductor, then obviously the resistance between these two points will reduce. Now you are providing a constant voltage over here between these two points A and B. And the resistance between A and B can be controlled by the voltage V1. So what I can write is the resistance R between the two points A and B can be written as a function of the voltage V1 if the capacitor is constant. I mean, if this construction is fixed and everything is constant, then this resistance between these two points, A and B, can be made as a function of V1. And if V1 increases, then the resistance will reduce and vice versa. So if V1 increases for a fixed value of V2, the resistance reduces. So let me write down over here. If V1 increases, then it implies you have more number of negative charge carriers, mobile charge carriers. Then the resistance between these two points, R, A, B, will drop down. And for a fixed value of V2, if RAB reduces, then obviously the current IAB, so if I consider this current to be IAB, the current that is flowing from the point A to point B, because that is the direction of the conventional current, so this IAB will also increase. So now you find an interesting observation over here. What you find is the resistance between these two ends, between these two points, is controlled by one voltage, that is V1. And if you can control the resistance, then for a fixed value of this voltage source V2, the current between these two points can also be controlled. So ultimately, from this structure, what you can have is a voltage-controlled current source. Because the current between these two terminals, between A to B, can be controlled by tuning the voltage V1. By tuning the voltage V1, the current can be controlled for a fixed value of V2. So even if these two voltage, I mean, the voltage difference between these two points, A and B, is fixed, still the resistance can be controlled just by changing the voltage V1. So ultimately, it gives rise to the concept of a voltage dependent or voltage controlled current source. That is the biggest observation that you can have from this particular structure. Now, if you perhaps you have understood from your basic knowledge in the small signal model of the transistors that if you can have a current controlled current source, because the standard bipolar junction transistors, they are current controlled current source, and you have seen that using those current controlled current source, you can ultimately design one amplifier. So you have designed different types of amplifier, like common collector amplifier, common base amplifier, common emitter amplifier, the cascade amplifier, cascode amplifier. So you have designed different types of amplifiers just by using the bipolar junction transistor. And essentially, the bipolar junction transistor is a current controlled current source. If you can remember the small signal model, you understand that it's basically a current controlled current source. Now, an important question which might be asked at this moment is that if you have a voltage controlled current source like this, is it possible to design an amplifier using this type of structure? If you can design an amplifier using the voltage controlled current source, then obviously this particular model will be helpful for the design of an amplifier. But the problem is that whenever you are going to design, because whatever I have shown over here on a two-dimensional board is not feasible to design on an wafer. So whenever you are making an attempt to design some chips, some IC chips on a wafer, then obviously it is very difficult to have a connection like this, because I don't know whether you have enough knowledge, whether you have seen the wafers or not. So normally for the wafers, the connections are taken from the top. You don't have any provision to take the connection from the sides. So here you have, if you just closely observe this particular structure, you'll see that there are four connections for the application of the voltage. This connection, and these two. So this connection is from the top. These two are from the sides, and this is from the bottom. So as far as the design of the wafer is concerned, it is not possible to take the connection from the side or from the bottom. So what you need to do is that you have to make certain arrangements so that this connection, these connections, these three connections can be taken from the top as well. So to understand this one, let me just go to the three-dimensional view of this. So let me just first draw the conductive plate one, a three-dimensional view. It's a certain amount of thickness. So this is the conductive plate one, right? And then you have this insulator with certain amount of thickness. This is the insulator. So as per the color coding, you understand that this is my conductive plate and this green one is my insulator. So you can take the connection from the top. So this is one terminal from where you can take the connection, right? So let me just mark this point. Now, if you just go back over here once again, now you have this connection over here. These two connections are taken from the side. So what you need to do is that you have to take this connection from the top. That means you have to make certain arrangement so that these connections can be taken from the top as well. These two side connections. So what you can do is, instead of taking the connection from here, you can take a connection like this. So this is my conductive plate two, and you are taking the connection from the top. So this is my conductive plate two, the second plate. So let me just make it parallel. So this is the second conductive plate, and you are taking the connection from the top, like this. And this is the P-type semiconductor on which this entire wafer is built, on which this entire chip is built, and the device is built. So let me just use that part. Yeah. So this is the substrate on which you are building this entire thing. So this is a P-type substrate. Sometimes it's also known as the body. P-type substrate on which you are building this entire construction. And as I've already mentioned, so these two connections, these two side connections are taken from the top itself. So you have one connection over here, one contact over here, and another contact over here, like this. And you are taking the connection from this point. So this is a point, as you understand, this is point A, this is point B, and suppose this is point C. And you have another connection left. That means this one. So this connection is taken anywhere over here. And this is known as the substrate connection. I have just shown a part of it. Substrate connection And this is, let me just identify this by S. However, the type of each of these different regions are not the same. We have built this entire thing on a p-type substrate, and these two, this A and B, the corresponding type of the semiconductor is N plus. So gradually understand why these two are N plus. So these two are N plus. You understand what is meant by N plus. That means N-type semiconductor with a very high value of doping. And this one is P plus. So whenever you are taking a connection, a wire connection, so it's very difficult to take a wire connection from a semiconductor. Because for the wire, if you just try to understand the notion of ohmic contact and the diode contact, then you understand that if I take the connection directly from a p-type semiconductor or from n-type semiconductor, then the corresponding contacts will not be ohmic. You can have a kind of diode contact, rectifying contact. So that's why whenever you can or you want to take a connection, this should be p plus or n plus. Now for the p-type substrate, you are taking it like a p plus. However, for these two, the polarities are, I mean, the type of semiconductor are not the same. This is N plus and N plus respectively. Gradually you understand why this N plus is there. Before that, let me just tell you, this one is the conductive plate one, as you understand, this top one. This is the insulator. And these are the two regions which play a very vital role in controlling the amount of current flowing between these two terminals, and this entire thing is built on a substrate. Now, the next question is that suppose already we have marked those four different terminals or four different points for a device like this, and what you can find is on the top plate, although it is known as the conductive plate, but it is not actually metal. Long back, it was built using metal. But now it is built using a polysilicon kind of thing, or polycrystalline silicon kind of thing, which is not exactly metal, but it is having a good amount of conductivity. And in between these two, you have an insulator, and this insulator is nothing but an oxide. So since this entire chip is built on silicon kind of, so therefore, this insulator is a kind of oxide, and that is nothing but silicon dioxide, SiO2. So this insulator is also called for this kind of structure as an oxide or silicon dioxide. So on the top, you have a metal. Now you have a polysilicon, but as far as the conductivity is concerned, they're almost close to each other. Then you have some oxide layer over here. So let me just mark over here. So this is metal. This is oxide. This is oxide, normally identified by this hashed line to make sense that this is nothing but an oxide layer insulator, which serves the purpose of insulation. So metal, you have metal over here. Then you have oxide. And then underneath this, you have a semiconductor. You have metal on the top, then oxide, and then the semiconductor. So ultimately, this gives rise to metal, oxide, semiconductor. Metal, oxide, semiconductor. And it is not over yet, metal, oxide, semiconductor. You have seen that the amount of current flowing between these two, whenever you provide certain amount of voltage between the different terminals, then the amount of current that is flowing between these two, they are basically controlled by the amount of voltage applied at this particular terminal. So it's a voltage controlled current source, and since it is voltage controlled, this is known as metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. Why transistor? Because you have a transfer of resistance. At the input side, you will find that the resistance is infinite. And then over here, the resistance can be controlled. So metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. So in short, or well-known MOSFET. Metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. And here you find that whenever you provide some positive voltage at this particular terminal, then you have the positive charge over here and the negative charge over here. And here the current conduction is primarily due to the flow of electrons. Now, since the current conduction for this kind of structure is primarily due to the flow of electrons, so that's why this type of MOSFET is known as N-type of MOSFET. So this is the structure for NMOS. Because the current conduction takes place because of the flow of electrons. And remember, unlike a bipolar junction transistor, this is a unipolar device. Bipolar junction transistor was not a unipolar device. It's a bipolar. So that's why the name bipolar. So the current is being conducted because of the flow of both electron as well as holes. But here, for an NMOS, the current conducts because of the flow of electrons. And for the PMOS, the current conducts because of the flow of holes. So for NMOS, the substrate that you are using is P-type substrate. So sometimes it is confusing that NMOS is being constructed on a P-type substrate or P-well. This is also known as P-well. As far as the microelectronics terminology is concerned, it is known as P-well. So the NMOS is constructed on P-well and the PMOS is constructed on N-well. So you have a P-type substrate on which you are constructing the N-type MOS. And these two are N plus and N plus, and this one is P plus. Similarly, for the P-type MOS, this will be N-type substrate. You have P plus over here, and this will be N plus. However, the topmost level will be metal, and this one is the oxide. Now, as far as these two points are concerned, A and B, what you find is, if you apply some voltage over here, so let me once again go back to the previous slide. If you apply some positive voltage over here at this point with respect to this, the electrons start flowing from point B to point A, and accordingly, the current start flowing from point A to point B. So we can visualize that this particular point, so that since the electrons are flowing from this point, B to A, we may visualize that the electrons, so this is the source of electrons. So from where you have the electron, you have the significant amount of electrons coming by virtue of, or by applying this particular voltage. And ultimately, these electrons are collected over here. Now, since this point is considered to be the source, and this point is considered to be the sink, so in the terminology of the electronic device, this particular region is known as, this region B is known as the source, and this region A is known as the drain or sink. So normally the drain and source, so these two terms are considered, because if you consider source and sink, so both of these two words starts with S. So that's why one terminal is known as the source and the second terminal is known as the drain. So this is called the gate. This is called the source. And this is called the drain. So these are the three terminals, gate, source, and drain. So why is it known as gate? Because as you know, what is the function of gate? The function of gate is to control something. So we have gates everywhere. In every building, we have gates. In our house, we have gates. In hospitals, we have gates. In every building, we have gates. So what is the utility of having a gate? Because this can control the flow of something. So here, as you understand, initially I have told you that just by applying or just by controlling the charge over here, you can basically control the current. So the current is getting controlled by the application of this voltage, and this voltage is applied at this particular plate, that is conductive plate one. So the voltage at the conductive plate one basically controls the charge carriers, which are present over here, and ultimately this will control the flow of current, or this will control the resistance between these two points, A and B. So that's why this particular conductive plate, a top plate, is known as the gate, because it controls the amount of charge induced, and ultimately it controls the flow of current. So that's why the name is gate over here. And you understand why it is known as source and why it is known as drain. And this one, this terminal is known as the substrate. Substrate sometimes is also known as body, or sometimes it is also known as bulk. So you can use like substrates. Let me write like this substrate. So ultimately, this metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor MOSFET is a four terminal device. You have four terminals. Initially, in your understanding, the first device that you have seen is a resistance in physics. Then you have seen the capacitor. Then you have seen inductor. So you have seen different types of devices like this. Then diode. So resistor, capacitor, inductor, diode. So all of them are two terminal devices. Then you have seen a three terminal device in the form of BJT, bipolar junction transistor, three terminals, emitter, base, and collector. Now, this particular device is a four terminal device: gate, drain, source, and substrate. And the operation of this kind of device is basically controlled by these three terminals: gate, source, and drain, primarily between these three terminals. However, substrate also plays some vital role. Gradually understand what is the role of the substrate. Initially, if you just consider that, okay, the substrate potential being a fixed, a reference voltage kind of thing, then the entire operation of the device is getting controlled by applying the voltage between these three, gate, source, and drain. Although substrate also plays some vital role. So ideally, this is a four-terminal device, but in most of the practical considerations, we simply get rid of substrate, assuming that it is kept at a constant voltage, a fixed voltage, reference voltage. But sometimes you understand what is the role of substrate as well. Okay. So now you have three terminals, gate, source, and drain. And more importantly, the appearance of source and drain seems to be a symmetric one. What I mean to say is that here we have applied some positive potential over here and negative potential over here. That means point A is at a higher potential with respect to point B. And that's why we have called point A as the drain and point B as the source. Now for the same structure, if you just change the polarity of this particular voltage source, that means if the positive potential is applied at point B and the negative potential is applied at point A, that means if point B is at a higher potential as compared to point A, then what happens? The electrons start flowing from point A to point B, and the current will flow from point B to point A. So therefore, the appearance of these two points, A and B, or their naming, can be interchangeable. So if I apply positive voltage over here, then this point will be known as, I am talking about in terms of NMOS. So for an NMOS, if you apply a positive potential over here, then it is known as, this terminal is known as the drain. And if I apply a negative potential over here, this is known as the source. So therefore, as far as the construction is concerned, if you apply positive potential at point A, So point A is known as the drain. And if you apply a positive potential at point B with respect to point A, obviously, then this is known as the drain. So the appearance of the source and drain, this is completely interchangeable. So that is another important property of the MOS device. This is basically symmetric. So gate is having a completely separate characteristics, because between gate and between this semiconductor, you have some insulator. So it should not be confused with the other three terminals. So gate is having a completely different property. However, this source and drain, they can be interchangeable. So that is an important property of this MOS device. And normally, whenever we deal with this in our circuit level, then obviously it is very difficult to draw this entire thing. So that's why we prefer to draw in a symbolic form like this. So you have gate on the top. Then in between, you have some insulator. And then this is the, so insulator is shown just by nothing. That means, so this is the, as you know, this is the symbol of a capacitor. So you have a gate over here. And this is a substrate, semiconductor. And you have two terminals, this one and this one. And to distinguish between these two in the circuit level, what is done is one arrow is pointed like this. This arrow signifies that this is my source end. So this is the source end, this is the drain end, and this is the gate. And sometimes, if needed, the body or bulk is identified by a dotted line like this. So normally, it is not mentioned like a substrate in the circuit level, because the same problem arises, source and substrate. Both of these two words starts with S. So that's why most of the books you'll find that these four terminals are identified by four different letters. G stands for gate, obviously. D stands for drain. A stands for source. And B stands for body or bulk. So don't get confused. So B means, so G means gate, quite obvious. So B is nothing but body or bulk or substrate, same thing. Body or bulk or substrate. So these are the four terminals, and symbolically it is shown like this. So whenever we use this particular device in different types of circuits, then obviously we should not be using this particular, this three-dimensional view, neither this two-dimensional view. Only we use this particular symbolic form consisting of four terminals: gate, drain, source, and body. So since you have four different terminals, so you can apply voltages accordingly. And one terminal can be considered to be a reference terminal. In most of the cases, you will find that the source and the substrate, they are at the same potential, and this potential is considered to be the reference potential. So with respect to this, you are going to apply two different voltages, one at gate, one at drain, and the circuit operates accordingly. But in some of the cases, you can also find that the source and the substrate, source and the body, they are not at the same potential. And then you find certain amount of impairments as far as the operational circuit is concerned, which are known as the second order effect. So we'll be definitely discussing the different types of second order effects. And one of the important second order effect comes because of the fact that the source and the body, they are not at the same potential, right? So as far as the applied voltage is concerned, we can generally think of two voltages, one at the gate terminal, second one at the drain terminal. Now, as far as the current is concerned, what could have been the possible source of current? Already I've seen that one current that is flowing from this drain to source. That means the electrons are flowing from source to drain and the current is flowing from drain to source. That is the one component of the current. Can there be any other component of the current? Can there be any current flowing through gate? Ideally, no. Because there is an insulator between these two. Now, since you have an insulator between these two, so for all practical computations, we can simply neglect the amount of current flowing through this. However, you can have a very small amount of current flowing through this, but that can be completely negligible. Ideally speaking, there is no current flowing through the gate. So the only source of current, only component of current is between source and drain. The amount of electrons that leaves this N plus source region will be ultimately collected at the drain end. So the drain current, the current that is entering at this point and the current that is leaving at this point, so these two currents being the same. So the drain current and the source current being the same, the amount of current that will enter through one terminal will ultimately be collected at the other terminal. So this is unlike the bipolar junction transistor. You have seen that for bipolar junction transistor, what happens is the collector current and the emitter current, they are not exactly same. You know that the emitter current is somewhat higher than the collector current. You have the base component, the base current is there. So emitter current is the summation of these two, collector current plus the base current. Because you have a certain amount of base current, because of the base recombination, you have a certain amount of base current that is also there. But here, the drain current and the source current being the same. So that's why it is also known as the ID. This current is also known as the ID, the drain current, or the source current, or in some of the books, you'll find that this is known as IDS, that is drain to source current, right? Now, suppose, let me once again come back to our original two-dimensional view. Now, you have this conductive plate. You have second conductive plate over here. And you are going to apply some voltage between these two. And for the time being, let us assume that this voltage is a variable one. And let us see what happens. It's a variable voltage starting from zero, for example. So this voltage, so I can safely call this voltage to be say VG, the gate voltage, because now we know what is the naming. What is this terminal called? It's a gate terminal. So it will be better to call it a gate and the voltage to be say VG. And you have an insulator in between. So this is the insulator. Let me just show it by a hatched line. And suppose these two points, this drain and the source, they are at zero potential. That means they are at ground. That means no voltage is being applied between these two. And suppose this is a variable one. This said positive, this said negative, but it's a variable one. Let us try to understand what happens. So symbolically, what we can show is you have three terminals like this. For the timing, let us just forget about the body terminal. So this is the gate. So you are going to apply some voltage over here, VG. This is grounded. This is also grounded. So symbolically, it is something like that. So the structure, what I have shown in the last slide, so this structure has been just flipped by 90 degrees. And ultimately, we have got this structure. Okay. Then what happens? Initially, suppose you have applied some very small amount of VG, let it be say 0.05 volt or 0.09 volt or 0.1 volt like this. And you are increasing the voltage. As you know that initially, as you provide a positive voltage over here, then you have the positive charge carriers on this conductive plate. And since you are applying the positive potential over here, what happens? This is basically a p-type semiconductor, as we're talking about. And you know, for a p-type semiconductor, you have an enormous amount of holes, because holes are the majority carriers for p-type semiconductor. So if we apply some positive voltage over here, so what happens? The holes will be repelled, because you are applying positive voltage over here. So holes being positively charged, so they will be repelled. And as a matter of fact, what they leave behind? They leave behind ions, and they leave behind negative ions. So holes will be repelled back, and they leave behind the negative ions. Remember, these are ions, so these are immobile ions. Just like this. And they cannot contribute to the flow of current. They are immobile ions. Now, as you are increasing the value of this VG, as VG increases, then obviously the more amount of holes will be repelled back, and you can have more layers of these negatively charged ions. Remember, these negatively charged ions, they cannot. So these are ions. And remember, they cannot contribute to the flow of current. And if you go on increasing like this, if you go on increasing the gate voltage like this, the concentration of these ions will be increased. Then the next question is that how can this particular device operate? Now a point will come when VG reaches a sufficient amount of voltage, a positive voltage for this kind of structure, when some of the electrons will also be attracted because of the application of this positive voltage. Because you know, this is an p-type semiconductor, so you do have certain amount of electrons. Electrons are the minority carriers, but obviously there will be certain amount of minority carriers as well. And moreover, you have two n plus regions over here. These two regions are n plus, so heavily doped n regions. So initially, when you apply some positive gate voltage over here, so this PN junction behaves like a reverse bias junction, because this is nothing but the enhancement of the depletion region. What happens in a reverse bias PN junction? In a reverse bias PN junction, if you go on increasing the reverse voltage, what happens? The width of the depletion region will increase. For a PN junction, if you apply a forward bias, then the width of the depletion region will be reduced. And if you apply reverse bias, and if you go on increasing the reverse bias, the width of the depletion region will increase. And this is known as a depletion region, because this is depleted of the charge carriers. You don't have any charge carriers over there, the mobile charge carriers. So as you go on increasing the VG, the gate voltage, what happens is the amount of these negatively charged ions will increase, the concentration will increase, and a point will come when some of the electrons, either from this p-type semiconductor or from these n plus regions, they will come forward and they will be attracted. They will be attracted towards this surface, this oxide semiconductor surface. They will come over here. And these are mobile charge carriers. And when this is coming to the front, then we can say that now we have a provision of current flow between this end and this end. So this is, this end is known as you know, this is the drain end, this is the source end. So as long as you have only this immobile ions, then you don't have any provision for the current conduction to take place. And once you have, once VG is equal to VTH, which is known as a threshold voltage, might be 0.3 volt or 0.4 volt, depending upon the construction of the circuit or construction of the entire device. When the VG reaches threshold voltage, VTH, then the electrons will come into the picture. And now you can have a different kind of filling. Initially, you have a p-type semiconductor over here, and you know that since it's a p-type semiconductor, so we do have only the holes as my charge carriers, because holes are the majority charge carriers for the p-type semiconductor. But because of the application of this positive voltage over here, the holes will be repelled back, and this region just under this oxide layer will be devoid of any charge carriers, right? And then ultimately, for a fixed value of VG, let it be say threshold voltage, or when VG exceeds the threshold voltage, you have the electrons coming into the picture. They are coming in the front. This oxide semiconductor interface will be populated by the negatively charged electrons, mobile electrons, and they can contribute the flow of current between this point and this point. And once this happens, once this phenomenon happens, this phenomenon is known as the population inversion phenomenon. Perhaps you have already known about this particular phenomenon. This is known as the population inversion. You can have a different kind of filling. It's a p-type semiconductor. It is expected that everywhere you find only holes, and there could have been some amount of electrons, because electrons are the minorities. Only you can find the holes everywhere. But whenever this condition holds good, you find that this underneath this oxide layer, in this oxide semiconductor interface, you have everywhere electrons. So it will behave. So this part of the semiconductor, this part of the substrate, will behave like an n-type semiconductor. Although it's a p-type semiconductor, but this part of the semiconductor will behave like n-type semiconductor. And this phenomenon, this event, is known as population inversion. And when this happens, we call that this is the creation of a channel of charge carriers between the drain and the source. So the channel is formed. So the channel is only formed when the gate voltage is equal to or is greater than the threshold voltage. When the gate voltage is exactly equal to the threshold voltage, then the channel is just formed. And now if you apply any voltage between drain and source, then the current starts flowing. And if you increase the gate voltage beyond this threshold voltage, obviously you understand that then the phenomenon we have already discussed, that if you increase the value of V1 over here, you can have more number of electrons over here. The density of electrons will be increased, and the resistance between these two points will reduce, and the current flowing between these two terminals will also increase. But that happens later on. First of all, you have to identify, or you have to understand whether the electrons will come over here or not. That will only happen if the gate voltage is just greater than or equal to the threshold voltage. And even if the gate voltage is equal to the threshold voltage or greater than the threshold voltage, we can say that the device becomes on. We can have sufficient amount of electrons, sufficient amount of charge carriers, but there cannot be any flow of current. So although the device is on, there is no flow of current until and unless you apply any voltage difference between these two terminals. So that is a peculiar situation what you can find in MOSFET. The device is on. For a diode, what do you know? For a diode, if the diode is on, then the current will flow. If the diode is off, then the current will never flow. But for this case, you'll find that even if the electrons are present, even if the channel is created, so this is known as a channel of electrons. So when VG is equal to VTH, then channel of electrons will be developed. But even if the channel of electrons is developed, but you don't have any amount of current until and unless you apply any voltage between these two terminals, any voltage difference between these two terminals. So this is a peculiar situation. And if you go on increasing the value of VG beyond VTH, then obviously you can have more amount of charge carried over here. The electron density will increase. And then for a fixed value of this particular drain to source voltage, you can have the more amount of current. So now, let us assume that we do have a fixed value of drain to source voltage. Suppose this is fixed and we go on increasing the gate voltage, then what happens? As I've already told you that there could have been the possibility of two different voltage sources. One is the voltage between the gate and the bulb, gate and the body. And the second one is the voltage between the drain and the source. Now suppose we keep one voltage constant. We keep one voltage constant and we vary the other voltage and try to understand what about the nature of the current. So this current is known as the drain current or ID, or sometimes is also known as IDS, drain to source current. So you can write either ID or IDS. And initially we are interested, I think it will be better if I just show two diagrams on this particular slide itself. Then you can compare. So ID is the amount of current, or IDS is the amount of current, and we are interested in knowing what about the nature of ID with respect to VG, the gate voltage. As you know, as long as, and this entire thing happens for a fixed value of VDS, where VDS is greater than zero. So let us assume that VDS is greater than zero. We have some positive drain to source potential being applied. Now, even if the voltage is there, but if the gate voltage is less than the threshold voltage, so the channel is not created, the device is not on. Now, if the device is not on, even if you have applied voltage between these two terminals, but the resistance between these two points are infinite. So the resistance between these two points is infinite. So even if you apply some voltage, you don't have any current. And this happens until this point. This point is known as VTH. So until this point, you don't have any current. So the current will be zero. The drain current will be zero. So when the gate voltage exceeds the one threshold voltage, that is VTH, so you have a number of electrons over here. So the current conduction takes place because already you have provided some positive drain source voltage. So what happens as you increase the gate voltage? You know that the electron concentration, the density of the electrons will also increase. So the drain source voltage is greater than zero, but it is not varying, it's fixed. So as you increase the gate voltage, in my first slide, it has been already mentioned. If this voltage increases, then for a fixed value of capacitance, the density of electrons will be more. And if the density of electrons is more, that means the resistance between these two points will reduce. So for a fixed value of the voltage, fixed value of the drain to source voltage, the current will increase. So it will increase. So it will increase. We don't know in what shape, but it will increase. So the variation of ID versus VG will be a monotonically an increasing function like this. It will increase. We don't know whether it will increase linearly or non-linearly. So for this, you have to study these ID VG characteristics of the device. And definitely we'll be discussing this one in some later class. Then you consider the second variation. That means the variation of drain to source current, drain source current IDS, with respect to VDS. And here we assume that the gate voltage should be greater than the one threshold voltage. That means the channel is already created. Now, since the channel is created, so already you have a plenty of electrons over here for the current conduction to take place. So when this drain to source voltage is equal to zero, that means the applied voltage is equal to zero. So no matter what about the number of electrons over here, if the applied voltage is equal to zero, the current will be zero. So this curve will start from zero point. So when VDS is equal to zero, IDS will also be zero. Now, as VG is greater than VTH, and we have kept the gate voltage at a fixed value so that the electron concentration, the density of electrons is fixed. So the resistance between these two points is also fixed. And suppose you are increasing the drain to source voltage. So you simply apply Ohm's law. The drain to source voltage increases with respect to that, the corresponding current will also increase, assuming that the gate voltage is greater than the threshold voltage. So then ultimately, it will be something like that. So it will start from zero point. You have fixed value of resistance because the gate voltage is constant. Gate voltage is constant, greater than the threshold voltage, channel is created, RAB is fixed. So for now, you understand that RAB is fixed, but as you move on gradually, you can also see that this, even if this gate voltage is fixed, but if VDS varies, this RAB is not fixed. That you can understand gradually, because so far, in order to make this discussion in a primary level, in a fundamental level, so far we have assumed that the density of electrons along this channel is constant, is essentially depending upon the gate voltage. But gradually you understand that this density of electrons is also a function of the drain to source voltage. So simplistically, although you assume that, okay, the density of electrons will be same everywhere, being the same beneath this oxide layer, everywhere being the same, if you just consider a unit volume of the semiconductor, you will find a fixed amount of electrons. That is not the case. You'll find that as you are traveling from the source end to the drain end, the density of electrons will also be modified, and accordingly the resistance between these two points, D and S, is a function of the density of electrons. So if the density of electrons is not uniform, then the resistance is not also fixed. So simplistically, you can say that, okay, the resistance will be constant, and if you increase VDS, IDS will also increase proportionately. So you can have a kind of linear graph, but practically not. So I'm just showing you the variation. So one thing is very obvious, that as you increase VDS, the IDS, that is the drain to source current, will also increase. So once again, whether it will increase linearly or non-linearly, that will depend upon another second order effect of MOS device, which is known as the channel length modulation. So as of now, if we just get rid of channel length modulation, if you want to make it very simple, then you can understand that if VG is greater than VTH, then VDS will increase, I mean, the IDS, this drain to source current, will increase linearly with the drain to source voltage, and this will pass through the zero point. So this is the variation of IDS with respect to VDS. So we have applied two voltages. One is the gate voltage, second one is the drain to source voltage. And although I am saying like gate voltage, but it should be applied with respect to some reference. So let it be the body voltage. So gate body VGB, or if body and source are at the same potential, then VGS. So we have two voltages. One is VGS, second one is VDS. And we would like to know what is the variation of this drain to source current with respect to the gate voltage and with respect to the drain to source voltage. Now, these two graphs that I have drawn today is completely drawn on the basis of intuition, on the basis of our understanding of this particular device physics. In the next class, what we will do is we will find out the exact complete form expression of the drain to source current with respect to those different variables, because you understand that this drain to source current is ultimately a function of both the gate to source voltage as well as the drain to source voltage. So in the next class, what we will do is we will develop the exact closed form expression for the drain to source current or drain current in terms of the gate to source voltage and drain to source voltage, and then you will be pretty sure about the variation of this drain to source voltage with respect to those different drain to source drain to source current with respect to this drain to source voltage and the gate to source voltage. So the slope of these graphs can be determined easily just by finding out the derivative of this ID with respect to VDS and VGS. So this entire mathematical deductions will be done in the next class. And with this, I would like to conclude my today's introductory class on this analog MOS circuit design.